Good evening. I'm Fred Passman, and I'm the commander of the Continental Commandery of the United States, Naval Order of the United States. I want to welcome you all to this December issue of our Naval History Virtual Lecture Series. And before I introduce tonight's speaker, just want to remind anybody who doesn't already know that the Naval Order is unique in that we are the oldest American hereditary society in the United States. If you are not yet a member of the Naval Order, you can get more information by going to the Continental Commandery's website, which includes a link to the Naval Order website, where there's information about applying for Naval Order membership. As I think everybody here knows, our primary mission is to commemorate our sea service heroes, important events in our sea service history, and to promote awareness of United States naval history amongst folks who may not be familiar with our rich heritage in that regard. This evening, our presenter is going to be John Landry, same as our lecturer from last month, but this month, John's topic is going to be on the Battle of Coral Sea. As I introduced John last time, he was commissioned in 1962 out of Officer Candidate School, and served till 1965, when he returned to graduate school and earned his degrees, both an MBA and his architectural degree, and has spent his career as an architect in the Detroit area, spent his career as an architect that was out in California, in Los Angeles area. After retiring, and in 2013, John became a docent for the USS Midway Museum, and since then has been a docent and a speaker on various aspects of naval history and the history of the USS Midway. So, John, welcome to us this evening.
Well, thank you very much, Fred, and welcome everybody to the USS Midway Museum presentation on the Battle of Coral Sea. We've got a lot to cover, so let's get to it. The screen you see right now is our beloved museum in San Diego, and it's parked at Navy Pier right downtown San Diego. And tonight we're going to talk about the Battle of Coral Sea, which occurred primarily on the period 4 May to 8 May 1942. This is a slide of our famous Dauntless dive bombers, which were very prominent in the battle. And this is the torpedo bomber, the TBD Devastator, also heavily involved in the battle. Well, the Coral Sea is some 4,300 miles southwest of Pearl Harbor, and a very large battle site it is. And the Battle of Coral Sea occurred as a U.S. reaction to the Japanese expansion into Southeast Asia. The Japanese planned to capture Port Moresby in New Guinea and gain control of all of the Coral Sea Basin, own the rich resources of the area, and isolate Australia. As you can see, the red circle is the actual Coral Sea area, and the red circle indicates the basin, which included phosphorus, which could be used for ammunition, explosive fertilizer, and potash for farming and things like that. You'll see a dotted line in there, which illustrates the U.S.-Australian supply line, where United States was keeping Australia afloat and intending to build up army bases in Australia to eventually attack Japan. Coral Sea is a vast area of some 550,000 square miles. The diameter of the Coral Sea is 1,130 miles, and more to scale, it's the distance between the Canadian border and the Mexican border of the United States. The Coral Sea is the equivalent of all of the area of California, Nevada, Arizona, Utah, half of Colorado, and half of New Mexico, being covered by ships that travel at a rate of about 20 knots. And so the long-range recon effort becomes extremely important to locate the enemy and accurately identify their contacts. The United States had PBY flying boats with a ferry range of about 2,500 miles, whereas the Japanese had a flying boat that had a ferry range of about 4,000 miles. We also, both sides would send up scouts from the aircraft carriers, and their ranges were anywhere from 450 to 600 miles. And one of the issues you'll see in this presentation is the false ID of contacts by scouts in the area. This slide illustrates the daunting task of searching by aircraft. You can search for 400 miles and take just one slice, 1 degree slice sector out of the ocean. The radar was of limited use. It was a new technology. It had short range. And of course, we have a vast ocean to search. And finally, in carrier warfare, carrier battlefield imperative number one is to locate the enemy first, deliver the first strike attack, and then seize a decisive victory. The strategic commanders in the area up in the upper left there is Admiral Yamamoto, the supreme commander of the Navy in Japan. His subordinate is Admiral Inoue, the 4th Fleet commander in the Battle of Coral Sea. Our brilliant commander was Admiral Nimitz, located in Pearl Harbor. And then we had Admiral King in Washington, who was the supreme commander of the Navy forces. And then finally, we had General MacArthur in Australia trying to build up the army forces to eventually attack Japan. Between 1910 and 1942, the Japanese built an empire with stunning success. As you can see from this diagram, they virtually owned Southeast Asia down to Australia, invading Korea, Manchuria, China, and eventually Pearl Harbor. So this Japanese success between 1910 and 1942 infects them with what we describe as the victory disease. And in fact, the Japanese have embraced the notion of hubris. Hubris being an overbearing pride or presumption of arrogance, disregard for boundaries, and overconfidence. The Japanese now believe they have the manifest destiny to rule all of East Asia. In 1941, the world was at war. The Germans in 1939 invaded Poland, and we got attacked at Pearl Harbor in 1942. And during in 1942, the United States was in significant peril from a two-ocean war from the Japanese and the Germans. This is a summary of the early war in the Pacific, 1941, Pearl Harbor, 42, the defeat of the Allied forces in the Java Sea by Japan, Doolittle Raid in April 18th, which had a psychological effect on Japan. On May 4th is our Battle of Coral Sea, and then 1 month later, we have the Battle of Midway. So I'm going to go back to this. In the Pearl Harbor raid, it turns out that not a single U.S. Navy carrier was attacked or sunk by the Imperial Japanese Navy. Now Yamamoto becomes obsessed with destroying the U.S. carriers, and it becomes later the impulse for an attack on Midway. So you got to ask, why did Japan attack us at Pearl Harbor? as you can see from this slide, they really didn't come up with any advantage except for their superior proven battle at Navy conquest. We were a world leader in industrial capacity, oil production. We could survive a war of attrition. Their GNP was 10% of ours. And on top of all that, they imported 80% of their war oil, 74% of their metals, and 93% of their copper. And most importantly, during the World War II, they produced a single carrier between 1941 and 1945, which, by the way, once it was underway and at sea in 1944, it was sunk by a U.S. submarine with a single torpedo. In contrast, the United States built, during that same period, 32 aircraft carriers, SS class, and then three Midway class torpedoes. For the U.S., the war of attrition had begun. For Japan, it was an insurmountable deficiency. So the Battle of Coral Sea is a 30-minute naval battle of what I call the Titans in the Coral Sea on 8 May. And we all know now that the Coral Sea lies just northeast of Australia and southeast of Papua New Guinea, some 4,300 miles southeast of Pearl Harbor. The battle was engaged between the capital ships of two aircraft carriers by Japan, the major aircraft carriers, the Shokaku and the Zuikaku, their newest carriers in the Navy, and then a light carrier, Shoho, and then our two carriers, the Lexington and the Yorktown. It's the first naval battle between aircraft carriers, and it introduced the tactical learning curve for aircraft carrier warfare. And it's the first where all battle damage to the combatants was inflicted by carrier aircraft. This is one of our carrier aircraft, the SPD Dauntless Dive Bomber, which did a lot of damage to the Japanese forces. In addition, we had our torpedo bombers. This is a picture of the Devastator. And then we also had fighter cover, which was the F-4F Wildcat. And all combat was conducted with no visual contact between aircraft carriers. And during this period, we now see the emergence of aircraft carrier warfare, and the dominance of the battleship is receding. So this is the USS Yorktown, commissioned 30 September 1937. And we now have the second carrier of the U.S. forces, naval forces. This is the Lexington, commissioned 14 December 1927, somewhat older than the Yorktown. This is the Shokaku, the newest carrier in the Japanese Navy, commissioned August of 1941. And then their next newest carrier, the Zuikaku, commissioned in September of 1941. And then this is their light carrier, Shoho, commissioned also late 1941. So the strategic plan for the Japanese was to capture Port Moresby and control the entire Southwest Pacific. To do that, they wanted to and did capture Rabaul, Leh, Salamaua, which are on Papua New Guinea, and then Tulagi, which is on a Coral Sea island, and eventually take over Port Moresby and move on Australia later. Here's a diagram of Rabaul, Leh, Port Moresby, Tulagi, and the Coral Sea, and the Japanese were going to launch their attack from their very large naval base in Truk, in the South Pacific. They wanted to sever the U.S. supply line to Australia and deny the U.S. a counter-offensive from Australia. As you can see here from the line on the right there, that's our supply line, that dotted line coming in from the right. And then the Japanese wanted to expand its defensive perimeter of their homeland island, and most importantly for Yamamoto, eliminate the U.S. carrier fleet. Well, the strategic plan was set up by Admiral King in Washington, and it was very simple. Deny Japan any more conquests, South Pacific, maintain our supply line with Australia, and then mount a counteroffensive against Japan from Australia with the U.S. naval forces and those of the Army and MacArthur. This is a simple illustration of our basic strategy. Keep those supply lines open and then do some island hopping and eventually attack the homeland of Japan. In 1942, make no mistake about it, the Imperial Navy was the most, was the largest and most lethal navy in the world. You can see here they had six aircraft carriers. Down at the bottom, the two, Shokaku and Zuikaku, participated in the Battle of Coral Sea, and the top four participated in the Battle of Midway. This is a survey of their fleet. These two carriers were sunk at the Battle of Midway. The Hiro and Soyu also were sunk at the Battle of Midway. And the Japanese had five light carriers that participated in both Coral Sea, Midway, and the Alaskan campaign. U.S. Pacific Fleet is composed of the Lexington, Captain Frederick Sherman, hometown Port Huron, right near where I was born and raised. This is the Yorktown with Captain Elliot Buckmaster. The Saratoga at the time of the Coral Sea had torpedo damage and was in Bremerton, Washington, Captain DeWitt Ramsey. We also had the Enterprise with Captain Murray, which participated in the Doolittle raid just one about a half a month earlier. The Hornet with Captain Michener also participated in the Doolittle raid. And now in March, April, the Japanese were wondering what would they do with their spectacular success. And they called this their phase two of the Pacific War. We've seen this before. This is their spectacular success. So option one was to attack the naval base at Midway, destroy the U.S. carriers, and then threaten Hawaii. There's no doubt that the Midway operation is the strategic choice. Option two was attack Port Moresby, expand to Southeast Asia, gain their rich resources. And actually, Port Moresby is strategically a sideshow compared to Midway. Well, now we have the two main players in this discussion about which option to take. Option one was favored by Admiral Yamamoto, who was a powerful bully, and he demands approval of Midway first. Well, his counterpart Tanaka is also a very firm and able adversary of the Navy, and he says no to Midway, and he says no, never, because it's too far away. Well, Admiral Yamamoto bullies his way and gets an approval of the Midway operation, but the timing is going to change, as we will see. And then during this concession, Admiral Yamamoto makes a strategic blunder. He now allows Operation Port Moresby to go first, and then comes his strategic blunder, which is to concede the two newest carriers in his fleet to this sideshow of the battle of the Operation Port Moresby. So Port Moresby becomes first in May, Midway second in June, puts his two newest carriers at risk, an unnecessary risk for that. And now we move on to the American superiority in the Battle of Coral Sea and also subsequent battles in the Pacific. It's known as Operation Hypo, since the American Allied forces possessed superior intel located in Pearl Harbor. As you can see, they're operating out of the administration building, which, by the way, in the attack on Pearl Harbor, was not attacked and left intact. And they did their work in the dungeon, the so-called the basement area, and their leader was Commander Rochefort, and Commander Layton was the superior codebreaker of this group. The code forces were located in Australia and in Corregidor while we operated in the Philippines, and then Pearl Harbor and Washington, D.C. And in April of 1942, an amazing thing happens. We break the Japanese naval and diplomatic code JN-25. The Japanese are totally unaware that their code was broken, and the Japanese were counting on a secret attack on Port Moresby, which our code breakers eventually determined their plans. The American commanders in the Battle of Coral Sea eventually would get from our intel service the size and composition of the Japanese forces, actual detail of their operation plan, a periodic location of the carrier force, and the location of their invasion force, and occasional ship movements. Admiral Nimitz trusted his intel operation, HIPO, and he used it effectively. Prior to the battle, Japan has captured Rabaul, Lei Salamaua, and Tulagi. And here you can see in the blue dots what they possessed before the 4 to 8 May Battle of Coral Sea. And from those possessions, they could now blanket the Coral Sea with their seaplane long-range scouts, which put Fletcher and the American forces at some risk if they got inside those areas. Japanese used their flying boat. And when the Japanese captured Lei and Salamaua, and Admiral Nimitz found out about it, Admiral Nimitz reacted very strongly to the capture of Lei and Salamaua on Papua New Guinea. And immediately he sent Task Force 17 to the Coral Sea, Yorktown, the Lexington, 8 cruisers, 14 destroyers, and 2 oilers. So this is the American force that was sent in April. And a reaction to the latest move by the Japanese to take Lei and Salamaua. 2 carriers, 2 oilers. We had 8 cruisers and 2 from Australia, and then 14 destroyers. So the battle commanders in the Battle of Coral were Admiral Inoue, the commander of the 4th Fleet, Admiral Hara was commander of Division 5, the 2 carriers, the two new carriers, and the commander of the Coral Sea area was Admiral Takagi. Admiral Nimitz in Pearl Harbor. Admiral Fletcher, who was commander of the Coral Sea forces. Admiral Fitch on the Lexington, who had tactical command of the air wings. In April, the Japanese had their carrier divisions sortied up at Truk, their naval base, some 350 miles from Rabaul. This is their naval base. It was a major naval base for the Japanese. Carrier force was sortied in next to that base, carrier division 5, the 2 carriers, the 3rd carrier, Shoho, and then a support force. Then down to Rabaul is the invasion force. This is the staging at 29 April, just before the Battle of Coral Sea. So the lineup between the Japanese and the American forces were approximately equal. Of course, the Japanese had 5,000, roughly 6,000 troops in the area with troop transports, and they had one oiler and a seaplane tender and a bunch of minesweepers and submarines. So the battlefield plot for 8 May shows the red rectangle is the area that the Japanese generally operated in. The the yellow rectangle is the operational area for the American forces. Takagi in charge of the Japanese forces, and Admiral Fletcher on the Yorktown for the American Navy. So this is the plot for Admiral Fletcher as he plotted his way from roughly 3 May all the way to the final battle on 8 May. And down below, you'll see two blue circles. One is the Neosho and the other is the Sims. And this is the plot for the Japanese forces, basically staying north of the American forces. And then here's the combined plot, give you an overview of how these two forces kind of parried one another during the 4 May to 8 May Battle of Coral Sea. And you could focus on the white circle in the middle. We'll talk about this in a little bit. But at that point, both the American and the Japanese carriers were about 70 miles distant from one another, but never did engage at that point. And we'll talk about that in a little bit. And at 4 May, the Japanese are unaware that Fletcher and our forces are operating in the Coral Sea. So the period between 4 May and 6 May is a period of search. Attack the force of Japanese forces at Tulagi, refuel, misidentify contacts, search again, and that is the general view of the American effort. On 4 May, this is the track for Fletcher where he heads north. At this point, all the Japanese forces are about 400 miles north of Tulagi, refueling. Fletcher takes the opportunity to attack the Japanese forces at Tulagi. He runs three attacks, one at 8 in the morning, another one at noon, another one at 1,500 hours in the afternoon with 60 aircraft. He's very lucky that the Japanese forces were not turning the corner here, which they will eventually do, because Fletcher is alone and would probably get decimated if that were the case. But our efforts to attack Tulagi were very minimal and disappointing. Now that the forces in Tulagi have been attacked, Takagi is aware that we have at least one carrier in the area. And he stops refueling and steams to the Coral Sea intent on destroying the U.S. carrier. So on 5 to 6 May, these are the movement of the American Navy and the Japanese forces. Down below, we have Fletcher basically refueling and doing a recon effort to try to locate the enemy with no results. Then on 6 May, the Japanese flying boat does locate Fletcher and Task Force 17. He correctly reports the location of Fletcher and reports that back to Takagi at 1,000 hours in the morning on 6 May. Immediately, Takagi orders his two aircraft carriers to head south, starting at 1,000 hours, and engage Fletcher. So he heads south. And he's roughly maybe 200 miles away. And then at about 8 o'clock in the evening, 2800 hours. It's getting dark, and Takagi decides he's not going to attack. In fact, Fletcher is covered by some low clouds, and he turns around, as you can see here, and goes back and parks his carriers a little further north at 2400 hours. So the American forces would have been surprised. Takagi would have had a first strike attack, but that didn't happen. So now on 7 May, both sides exchange intense combat, and attacks were made on the Japanese. We made attacks on one carrier, Soho, and we also made an attack on the air wing for Zuikaku. The American oiler Neosho is attacked by the Japanese, as is its escort, the destroyer Sims. So at 600 hours in the morning, a scout for Takagi locates Neosho and the Sims. Sorry, I got to go back here. So his scout at 7:22 in the morning reports one carrier and one cruiser, when actually it's an oiler and a destroyer. Takagi orders Hera to attack and sink the carrier and cruiser that were reported back to him. Well, as we know, they attack both Neosho and Sims. Neosho gets hit with 7 bombs, major damage. Sims get hits with 3 bombs and sinks immediately. And now Fletcher has limited refueling capacity with only one oiler remaining. And that oiler drifts in the ocean for 4 days and is in danger of breaking up and sinking. The Henley comes by and at 1300 hours in 11 May and rescues 123 survivors in the ocean. During that fiery trip for the Neosho, Chief Water Tender Peterson performs his acts of bravery, and he gets receives on December 7th, 1942, he receives the Medal of Honor. At this point, the Japanese still do not know the location of Fletcher on 7 May. But on 7 May, based on our American operation Hypo at Pearl Harbor, from information received on 6 May, Fletcher gets a location of where Takagi is. And so he sends a recon mission out. He sends 10 dive bombers looking for the main carrier force. And as you can see, Takagi is over to the right on this display. But it turns out that our scouts search to the north and west. And eventually, a Yorktown scout locates the Port Moresby invasion force. And our scout sees the invasion force, and he erroneously coded a contact report showing 2 carriers and 4 cruisers, when actually what he saw was one light carrier, the Shoho. Fletcher believes he's located the main carrier force, decides to launch an all-out attack. He sends 93 aircraft from the Lexington and the Yorktown, some 250 miles to the target. And at 1 hour later, at 1100 hours, the first wave of Lexican dive bombers attack the light carrier Shoho, and their first wave attack does no damage. The second wave comes in from Lexington, dive bombers, and we get two bomb hits on the show hull, and it penetrates the flight deck, explodes in the hangar deck among a fully loaded, fueled, and armed aircraft. This is an actual Navy photograph of the show hull when it's hit with two bombs. Then a third wave from Yorktown comes in with their torpedo bombers with a pincer movement, and they get five torpedo hits on the show hull. This is another picture after those five torpedo hits. And then there's a fourth wave of dive bombers coming in from the Yorktown. Believe it or not, they get 11 bomb hits. And then the fifth wave comes in from the Yorktown. They get 10 more torpedo hits. Shoho is mortally wounded. Commander Dixon, who is one of our heroes of the Battle of Coral Sea, radios back to Fletcher, scratch one flat top. This becomes a famous quote for the Battle of Coral Sea. At 11:30, Shoho abandons ships, and 3 minutes later, it sinks with 834 casualties. At this point, Admiral Inouye now recalls the Port Moresby invasion force to Rabaul. And now the odds of holding Port Moresby tip in favor of the U.S. and its allies. And we see here the uncertainties of the battle were displayed in our recon pilot miscode of his contact. So now Inouye retires his forces, and now the Japanese still are unsure of the exact location of Fletcher. But on 7 May, the United States Navy shatters the air wing of Zuikaku Naval Force. Admiral Hara gets a report from his scout at 1500 hours on 7 May. And the scout reports that he sees one carrier. Sorry. The scout reports that he sees a carrier force and reports that back to Takagi. And Hara sends his first wave of scouts to confirm. He sends 8 scout bombers with his most experienced pilots to check out this contact. 1 hour later, Hara gets nervous, and he sends a second wave of 12 dive bombers and 15 torpedo bombers. 1.5 hours later, they're returning, having not found any aircraft carrier forces of the United States. So the second wave is coming back with 27 aircraft, but the Yorktown picks them up on radar. And Fletcher sends 11 U.S. fighters, which were vectored to their target by the Yorktown radar. And now we, at 1700 hours, we have a dogfight between the U.S. and the Japanese pilots. We down 9 of their aircraft. We lose 3. But oddly enough, at 2000 hours, the remaining Japanese fighters are looking to return and land on the Zuikaku. They actually misidentify the Yorktown as their carrier and come in and try to land on the Yorktown. And of course, the Yorktown opens up with AA and drives the pilots off. And now they find the pilots find their carrier, the Zuikaku. But when they try to land at night, this is what happens. 11 of their aircraft are lost in their night landings. So it turns out there's a aircraft loss of 20 aircraft for the air wing of the Zuikaku. That air queen is shattered and the Zuikako becomes ineffective as a fighting force. And eventually they're taken out of action on May 9 and will be unavailable for the Battle of Midway. And Admiral Hera pays a steep price for his impatience. Here we come to 8 May, the Battle of the Yorktown, Lexington, Zuikaku, and Suikaku. On this day, after all the searching in the vastness of the Coral Sea, the battle boils down to a patch of ocean of 150 miles square. You can see it here, about 500 miles southeast of Port Moresby, and about 300 miles southwest of Tulagi. U.S. and Japanese carrier forces think they know the location of the other force and their intent on doing battle. The search begins the early morning of 8 May for the opposing carrier forces. Both the U.S. and the imperial Japanese tactical commanders start their search at the same time. That would be Admiral Fitch and Admiral Hera. Hera launches 7 torpedo bombers to search for the U.S. forces. He searches to the south, and Fitch orders 18 U.S. torpedo bombers, and his search pattern is a circle to the northwest. Eventually, at 8:20 hours, the Lexington pilot Joseph Smith and the Shokaku pilot Kenzo Kano make an enemy contact. Both of us have made contact. We're about 200 miles apart, and both forces change course to close the distance for battle. Between 8:40 and 9:15 hours, both sides launch an attack simultaneously. The U.S. launch an attack, and Fitch orders 75 aircraft, 39 dive bombers, 21 torpedo bombers, and 15 fighter aircraft. And 1.5 hours later, at 10:57 hours in the morning, the U.S. attack begins in 4 waves. At 10:57, the first wave of Yorktown dive bombers, then comes the second wave of Yorktown torpedo bombers. At 11:30 hours, Lexington is the third wave with their dive bombers, and then right behind that, their fourth wave with their torpedo bombers. So comes the first wave. Yorktown is going to dive on Shokaku. This is Commander William Birch who makes the first hit in the Battle of first bomb hit in the Battle of Coral Sea. And they come in at 10:57 hours and eventually unload their bombs, and they get one bomb hit in the forecastle portion of the Shokaku, which you will see here. This is an actual photo of the bomb hit and the explosion. A couple of near misses. Now, Shokaku is unable to launch aircraft. The next wave comes in with the Yorktown pilot, John Powers. He will get the second bomb hit. So as he's diving on Shokaku, he gets attacked by a Japanese Zero. His plane catches fire. He continues with his attack on the Shokaku, and he gets a bomb hit dead center in the flight deck, which causes major damage to the Shokaku. But at 200 feet, Major Powers was unable to pull out of his dive and is killed by his own shrapnel. And later, he is awarded the Medal of Honor. Right behind the first attack, the Yorktown torpedo bomber comes in on the Shokaku. This is our TBD Devastator torpedo bomber. And their fish is away, and their first attack shows no result. All their torpedoes missed their market mark. 30 minutes later comes the Lexington dive bomber attack on the Shokaku. And now we get a hit right in the center of the flight deck from the third wave of the Lexington dive bombers. And the remainder of our dive bombers can't locate either one of the Japanese carriers, so they return to their ship. A few moments later, however, cloud cover lifts, and now the Zuikaku, which was under cloud cover, becomes a target. And the Lexington dive bombers dive on the Zuikaku. And two bombs missed their target to starboard. There's no damage. And then a few moments later, the fourth wave comes in from Lexington, our torpedo bombers. And they fire no less than 11 torpedoes, and they get no hits. So now comes the question of our Mark 13 torpedo. The commanders, after action reports, claimed torpedo hits, but in actuality, there were no torpedo hits made. This is a picture of our Mark 13 torpedo, which has proven to be a defective torpedo and was clearly exposed in this battle. It took two more years until 1944 for design changes to make the Mark 13 torpedo an effective weapon. The after action report, we get three bomb hits on the Shokaku. We did major damage to the flight deck, as you can see here. They're unable to launch aircraft. Shokaku retreats from the battlefield. The air wing for the Zuikaku was shattered on 7 May. They escape our attacks on 8 May. And now the Japanese mount an attack which was simultaneous with the U.S. attack. Takagi launches 69 aircraft, 33 dive bombers, 18 torpedo bombers, and 18 Zeros. And 2 hours later, the attack begins in two waves. The first attack comes on the Yorktown with 4 torpedo bombers. These torpedo bombers are coming from both the Shokaku and the Zuikaku. The attack is made, and their first attack on the Yorktown shows no results. All the torpedoes missed with the evasive action that Yorktown was taken. But now 14 torpedo bombers attack the Lexington in a pincer attack coming from both sides. And now the Lexington is hit with 2 torpedo hits. It bucks the port aviation storage tank, ruptured their water mains, but the ship still could make 24 knots. Shortly thereafter comes another attack on the Lexington. And the Japanese dive bombers make 2 bomb hits on the Lexington, one in the flight deck and one in the island, as you can see here. And this is an illustration that the Lexington has taken 4 hits, 2 torpedoes low, one in the flight deck, and then one right down the stack in the island. We see massive flooding, damage to the forward ammunition locker, and the dive bombers have done significant damage to the Lexington. Immediately thereafter comes another attack from the Japanese on the Yorktown. This is at 11:20 hours in the morning. And these dive bombers make a hit right in the middle of the flight deck of the Yorktown. It explodes to the center of the flight deck and penetrates four decks down, killing or wounding 66, knocked out our superheated boilers, and made major structural damage to the Yorktown. There were near misses that actually inflicted more structural damage to the ship. This is looking from the hangar deck up through the flight deck where the Japanese bomb penetrated. This is four decks down showing the damage to the deck from the Japanese dive bombers. During the effort to save the Yorktown, Lieutenant Ricketts leads a damage control team and is mortally wounded. He helps save the Yorktown and gets later on gets a Congressional Medal of Honor, and he eventually dies of his wounds. And the damage control crew actually at 12 noon sees the Yorktown to live and fight another day at the Battle of Midway. So in 30 minutes, the Battle of Titans is over. The Japanese believe they have sunk two U.S. carriers. The Yorktown, however, returns to Pearl Harbor for repairs and is fights another day at the Battle of Midway. After combat at the Battle of Coral Sea, the Lady Lexington fights to survive. At 12:30 hours, they've managed to put out the fires and restore an operational condition through their heroic efforts of the damage control party. However, at 12:47 hours, there's a massive explosion. Fumes from a ruptured gas tank filled the hangar deck. Electric motor ignited it and produced the explosion. 3 hours later, there's another explosion which rocked the forecastle in the Lexington. As you can see, there was one aircraft here that was jettisoned. And 1.5 hours later, there's a final explosion starting more large fires. The Lexington seems to be doomed. And 3 hours later, at 1700 hours, the Captain Sherman orders abandon ship. You can see our sailors rappelling down ropes over the side of the Lexington. And at 1800 hours, we still have the captain, Admiral Fitch, and the XO on board. And it's at this point that Captain Sherman orders abandon ship. And at 1900 hours, the destroyer Phelps fires five torpedoes into the Lexington. 216 of the ship's crew go down with the ship. Admiral Inouye orders his forces to retreat and postpones the invasion of Port Moresby till 3 July. He orders Takagi to leave the area. And Admiral Nimitz sees that the invasion of Port Moresby has been denied. For the Japanese, it's the beginning of the end of World War II. This after-action report sees the Japanese lose a carrier. They put two of their newest carriers out of commission for the Battle of Midway. They lose 62 aircraft and have 1,074 casualties. We lose one carrier. We have damage to the Yorktown. We lose 66 aircraft, and we have 543 casualties. We lose the destroyer Sims and the Osho, and we sink some of the minor naval ships for the Japanese. We see four Medal of Honor recipients. Lieutenant John Powers, killed in action as a pilot on Yorktown. Lieutenant Ricketts, under damage control on the Yorktown, killed in action. Oscar Peterson, engineering on the Neosho, killed in action, and Lieutenant William Hall, a brave pilot in the Battle of Coral Sea. From the Lexington, he survives the battle. So the after-action analysis, hubris, and the victory to D resulted in rank dysfunctional infighting and forceful bullying by Admiral Yamamoto. Japan was led into a colossal strategic blunder in Operation Port Moresby. The two newest carriers were put out of action. For the U.S., the Japanese advance was stopped. Australia was saved. Australia now can be used as a base. Our intel broke the Japanese code and was useful for the rest of the war. And the Japanese, of course, were shorthanded in the Battle of Midway for their carrier force. The U.S. achieved its primary objective, halted the expansion of Japan's empire in Southeast Asia, and Japan was handed their first taste of an unsuccessful campaign in the Pacific theater. And finally, the Battle of Coral Sea leaves us with a question. What if Yamamoto had refused to cede two carriers in the Battle of Port Moresby invasion, and Yamamoto had six carriers instead of four to attack the U.S. carrier fleet at the Battle of Midway on 4 June? What is your answer? My answer is we would have sunk six carriers at the Battle of Midway. Thank you very much. Any questions?
Thank you, John. We're getting close to the top of the hour, so I'll have one question, and I think we have to limit it to that. It was interesting that neither the task forces had any battleships involved, and this is still fairly early in the war. Do you have any idea of why no battleships were accompanying? We can understand the U.S. fleet. We really didn't have any available. But the Japanese fleet, who had made quite a bit of use of battleships elsewhere, why did they sally forth without any battleships this time?
My answer is I haven't done any reading on this, but one real good observation is that the Japanese felt they were going to make quick work of the invasion of Port Moresby. They were going to do it by secret, in a secret manner. They had no idea that we had, you know, we had forces in the area. And I think that's part of the answer.
Very good. Let's see. There was one other question. Have you read anything to explain why Admiral Yamamoto decided to go for Port Moresby first before going after Midway?
Yes, and it has to do with the Doolittle raid several weeks earlier. It was a major psychological defeat for the Japanese Navy, putting the emperor at risk and putting and the notion that their island could be attacked at any time by our carriers. And so the notion of providing a protective perimeter for their islands came to the forefront. It became a major consideration in the strategic discussions.
Fascinating. You know, your discussion shows just how much luck plays in, especially with the resources available. Radar still fairly in its infancy. Cloud cover playing such a major role. With that, John, I want to thank you again for presenting this evening. And I want to thank those who participated live for their comments, for their participation. Also want to remind people that within the next week or so, a recording of this presentation will be made available and under the past events. Our next presentation will be on January 27th, Thursday evening, again at 1900 hours Eastern Standard Time. I want to thank you and look forward to seeing you in January. Wish you all a great holiday season and a healthy, productive 2022. And I've just ended the broadcast.